The particular case I'd like us to talk about in more detail is linear value function approximation. So that is in particular the case where our Q function is represented as a weighted linear combination of the features that represent the state and maybe the state in action, but we're going to keep the action separate for now.
Okay.
So this is how the Q function can be represented if we're doing things linearly. So we have this set of weights, WA sub I, and we have a set of features, or at least this function F that maps states to particular feature values. And let's say we've got n different features. So if we're representing things linearly, what we're doing is we're saying, let's sum over all the features for the current state, the value of that feature, times the weight that is being used to represent the Q function for this action. And just, yeah, sum that up. Essentially take the dot product between this feature vector and the weight vector. And it's these parameters, these W super A's, that are actually providing us the generalization, the ability to make a prediction to new states, because there's parameters that are shared between all the different states.
Sure, that makes sense. So it's like a neural network with nothing nonlinear going on.
Yeah, in this particular case, it is exactly a linear function.
Fair enough.
Which you can think of as being a neural net without any nonlinear and with a single layer.
Yeah, so in fact, you have a whole set of them. You have a whole set of neural networks all kind of happening in parallel. I suppose you could claim that they're one neural network with a nonlinearity, which is kind of some kind of max function or something that figures out which action you should take based upon each of the QS of A's. And so you really are kind of learning a neural network.
Yeah, I can agree with that. I mean, we're gonna talk a little bit more about using more general neural network structures in this setting instead of just linear weights. But the linear weight case is kind of easier for us to think about. And there's actually been a tremendous amount of research on this particular case, because the hope has been that it's more well behaved than what we get with nonlinear function approximation.
Usually is.
Let's think a little bit about what these weights are actually representing.
Okay.
One way you can think about the weight for a feature is that it gives a kind of sense of importance for each of the features in how much they're contributing to the action's value.
Sure. So if the weight sub A sub I is zero, then it doesn't matter what the feature is. It doesn't contribute at all.
That's right. So then it completely ignores the feature for that prediction.
And if the weight is a billion, then it means a lot, probably. And if it's negative a billion, it also means a lot, just in the different direction.
Right, sort of anti-importance.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, the feature depends upon how you want to interpret it. The F sub I produces a negative number, and the weight is also negative. You're saying that feature is really important.
Right.
And the negativeness it's kind of a function of the fact that you want Q values to be higher if you're going to use them.
Okay, all right. I think that's a good way to think about it. All right, so this kind of makes sense to you? Do you feel like you appreciate the notion of a linear value function approximator?
Yeah, I think so. That makes sense. You just add up all your features and weight them appropriately.
Cool. All right. So let's kind of make sure that we understand this.
Okay.